sad thing. Evening, students. I want to welcome you to this, our sixth week, I believe it is, of how to get off of drugs. We're videotaping this for our live class as I have other plans for our regularly scheduled class. But of course, for those taken by video anyway, it makes a little difference. Tonight, we're going to be looking at two main drugs, one an upper and the other a downer. Amphetamines will be discussed in the first session tonight, and then the second session, we're going to be looking at the general category of depressants. Now, of course, we have to keep in mind that an amphetamine is a specific upper. We have two major classification of drugs. We have our stimulants and our depressants, which are sometimes referred to as uppers and downers. Then, of course, in the category of stimulants, the amphetamines represent the largest group of drugs. And then again, in the second session tonight, we'll be looking at the general category of depressants. I'm going to give you five major effects of amphetamines, and then of course we'll be looking at these a little bit more specifically a little bit later on. But the first main effect is that amphetamines raise energy levels. Of course, this is important for people who are tired and run down and have to meet deadlines and so forth. A second, we would think in terms, I would think, of these as being positive effects. And we cannot deny that drugs of all types certainly have what we call, quote, positive effects. Or let me put it this way, desirable effects. And those desirable effects are the reason that people basically take the drugs. And of course, the desirable effects have to be measured alongside of the undesirable effects. Okay, amphetamines reduce appetite, of course, which is important for dieting. Amphetamines reduce the need for sleep. Which is certainly important if you want to stay awake. Amphetamines produce feelings of clear-headedness. Now, of course, this is under the most desirable conditions, and especially initially. And then finally, as far as our considerations are concerned, amphetamines create feelings of power and euphoria. Okay, let's take a little closer look at those, and I'll focus in so you can read those. Raise energy levels, reduce appetite, reduce the need for sleep, produce feelings of clear-headedness, and also produce feelings of power and euphoria. Then, of course, you have to take into consideration the risk, and there are several very significant risks, and among those risks would be serious physical and psychological harm, a rapidly rising tolerance. Of course, we define tolerance as being what? The need to increase the dosage in order to get the same effect. And the third risk, major risk, is profound dependency or a true addiction. Now, why would a person again want to take the drugs? For these reasons, of course, you have truck drivers who want to stay awake to make a run. You have students who want to stay up all night to cram for a test. Sometimes you have a businessman who wants to appear to be alert and he wants to be on top of things so he can make the best presentation. Sometimes you even have a housewife who wants to get going in the morning. Amphetamines were first synthesized in 1887, but it wasn't until about 1927 that doctors learned that amphetamines had certain medical uses, including earlier on as a decongestant, and it was also used in treating narcolepsy. Narcolepsy being a condition marked by incidents of falling off to sleep. Misuse of amphetamine started early. By the 1930s, amphetamine sulfite, which is a chemical name for benzedrine, was being squeezed out of inhalers, which were then available without prescriptions. Kamikaze pilots are said to have taken amphetamines before starting out on their suicide missions during World War II. Of course, we're referring to the suicide pilots of the Japanese Army. We have amphetamine-like drugs, which include Ritalin. Ritalin, of course, is a very popular drug, which is used to help to bring about some type of balance or to even out the activity of hyperactive children. In the 1960s, I'm just giving you a brief history here and some of the earlier usages of amphetamines, and then we're going to be looking at some of the present day trends. In the 1960s, there was a huge amount of stimulants which were being taken, especially in New York's East Village and as well as San Francisco's Hyatt-Asbury District. And a number of, quote, flyer children became what were known as speed freaks. And of course, this was a group of kids who became very drug dependent, isolated, uncommunicative, frightened, and violent. In the 1970s, there was more of a, more attention was drawn to the amphetamines, and a lot of restrictions were placed on amphetamines. At the height of the popularity of amphetamines, there, I think, was a report of about 12 billion dosages of amphetamines which were sold, and I'm assuming those were legal sales. And presently, to give you an idea about how those early numbers compare with as recent as the last 10, 12, 15 years, is probably between 5% and 10%. The usage, the legal use of amphetamines today is less than 10% of what it was in the early 1970s. And then, of course, with the added restrictions on amphetamines, drug addicts began to turn to other drugs of choice, and cocaine happened to be one of those drugs of choice. And that led to an increase of the popularity of cocaine in the 1970s. Amphetamines presently, besides the legal aspect and the legal availability of amphetamines, which by the way is quite limited, amphetamines are very rarely prescribed today. But the majority of amphetamine use comes through what we call bootleg drugs and bathtub drugs. Now, we make a distinction between the two. And I suppose that in one sense of the word, you could say that they're each pretty much the same when you talk about bootleg and bathtub drugs. But specifically, when we refer to bootleg drugs, we're talking about drugs which are produced in this country, but they're shipped abroad, supposedly for use abroad. You have to keep in mind that the restrictions here in this country have been mainly in the sale of amphetamines. So a lot of these drugs were produced to be shipped overseas, and then those drugs which are shipped overseas are then smuggled back into this country, and those are what we call bootleg drugs. And of course, your bathtub drugs are the drugs which are concocted in homemade laboratories and literally in bathtubs, mixed up in bathtubs. And this is extremely dangerous. And of course, methamphetamines are produced, what we call crank, is produced in bathtubs, in homemade laboratories, in just about every type of situation. I know that a short period of time, a couple of years ago, when Nancy and I were in Southeast Missouri, in Poplar Bluff, Missouri, that there was never a week that passed by that there was not a front page report of some bootleg or some bathtub laboratory which produced methamphetamines was busted. There was even a report of a mobile lab, a van that was used to move from place to place to produce the methamphetamines. There's also what we call the look-alike drugs, and these share the market with the bootleg amphetamines. And these look-alike drugs oftentimes would not even be the same drug, but it would be designed even down to the color of the capsule, and sometimes even with the imprinting of a code number that would seek to mimic or to duplicate the real drug. Let's take a look at today's stimulants. There are three major amphetamines, or three major stimulants, that we're going to consider. The first is just simply referred to as an amphetamine. And this is what is commercially known as Benzedrine. And I think the street name there is what? Benny's. Then you have your dextroamphetamine. And the brand name here is Dexedrine, street name being Dexys. And then we have our methamphetamine. The brand name is Desoxin, or Methadrine. These are what we call the three major stimulants of abuse. Amphetamine sulfite. Actually, benzodrine is amphetamine sulfite, or sulfate. And dextroamphetamine, which is dexedrine, methamphetamine, desoxin, or methadrine. Amphetamine, dextroamphetamine, and methamphetamine act in similar ways and produce almost identical effects, but they differ in potency. And usually these drugs are available in tablets and time-release capsules. We also made reference to Ritalin, which was an amphetamine type of drug. Another drug that comes under the category of amphetamine-like, or amphetamine, would be Preludin, which is a diet pill, and all of these drugs, which are legal, are classified as Schedule II drugs, according to the federal government, and this is a grouping of the most stringently controlled substances available for medical use. Doctors who prescribe stimulants today tend to favor Didrex, Presate, and Plegan, as well as Inomin. These drugs are much less potent than the amphetamines and amphetamine substances and are less tightly regulated. They're less potent. But guess what? Guess what addicts do when you have less potent drugs? You just take more of them. So drug abusers have been known to take large numbers of Didrex tablets daily. Now, we've already mentioned some of the general effects of amphetamines. Of course, I think that what we had addressed earlier on in the session was what we call, quote, the positive effects, or what we would call the desirable effects, what the drug user is looking for. Of course, when you take drugs of abuse, you not only get what you're looking for, but you get what you're not looking for. And some of the things that you would not be looking for and that would certainly be less desirable would be, well, such things as nervousness and paranoia, extreme fatigue. Of course, when you go through what we call a rush, we'll talk a little bit more about the negative effects in just a moment. Let's consider what is normally looked upon as a pattern of use. Again, it may begin with what you think is a reasonable, rational way of dealing with some, quote, problem situation, such as to overcome fatigue, to increase or to improve performance, or to complete a particularly difficult or time-consuming chore or piece of work. Again, this might be an ambitious businessman who starts taking amphetamines to remain alert through 12-hour work days. He wants to appear to be quick-thinking to his boss and to his clients. Housewives may want to lose weight or to get the energy to make it through the day. Even athletes are given to stimulant misuse. Cocaine seems to have taken the place of the amphetamines as far as athletes are concerned. And unfortunately, I think that probably a lot of drug abuse that is prevalent among athletes is encouraged by the philosophy that it's okay to take certain drugs to help you to play through the pain in the big game. And then you always have teenagers especially who will look to drugs of abuse simply for the kick of it. No matter what type of user, it is easy to move from casual, occasional drug taking to high risk use and drug dependency. What may start out to be a very, quote, innocent looking use of stimulants can sneak up on you. And it's oftentimes a very quick transition between casual use and a serious dependency. There is a mixture of methamphetamine. I think, let's see, that's mixed with heroin. And this is what is called a speedball. There was something that I read that was quite interesting, and this was what was referred to as the Dr. Feelgood Clinics, that apparently that you had some irresponsible doctors in the 1970s, back when the speed, and of course that's another name for amphetamines, is speed, was popular. You had clinics which were set up, and supposedly clients would come to the clinics to get vitamin shots, but the vitamin shots would be mixed with speed. There are various ways of taking amphetamines, as I said, that they come in pills as well as capsules, but they can also be injected intravenously. And this type of injection produces the strongest and sharpest rush. There's a distinction between a rush of drugs and the euphoria. The rush oftentimes is initially is very intense and very short-lived, sometimes just for a few minutes. But amphetamines can produce a feeling of euphoria for several hours. Whatever the type of user or method of ingestion, amphetamine use is usually followed by depression, difficulty sleeping, and nervousness. And then, of course, in an effort to circumvent these negative consequences, namely the depression and the difficulty of sleeping and nervousness, a drug abuser or an amphetamine user will often turn to sedatives, depressants such as alcohol, and then you get caught up in the upper-downer cycle. As tolerance builds, a user may inject huge dosages in an attempt to get a rush and to reach a satisfactory high. Now, we said that amphetamines are highly addictive. Tolerance is built very quickly, and then there is always the effort of reaching that same intense feeling of the rush and also to get the high, and this leads to runs. This would be very similar to some of the other drugs that we've already studied, and so far we've studied what? We've talked about narcotics, did we not? Which, of course, would be the opiates, and let's see, what was the other drug? Cocaine. Yeah, cocaine, of course, being a stimulant, and the narcotics. And oftentimes, a user, which of course becomes an abuser, will seek to circumvent or to avoid the crash, and that's what leads to what we call a spree, going on a spree or a run. When the run finally ends and the crash comes, users, now we're talking specifically now about the amphetamine users, users are exhausted, disorganized, and wound up. They may need sedatives to get to sleep, but then stay asleep, listen to this, for up to 48 hours and longer. I know that Nancy and I have had some up-close personal encounters with amphetamines, methamphetamines, and I know that according to one report that I had received, that a person who would take an amphetamine, and especially a methamphetamine, which is crank, will go full speed for several hours. I mean, it just be like just wound up, full of energy, full of activity, and then of course when the crash comes, can sleep from 24 to 48 hours. We've already mentioned some of the unpleasant effects. Let me mention a few more: dizziness, headaches, nausea, wheezing, muscle and chest and back pains. Users sometimes feel confused. Their hands shake. They become flushed, sweat a lot, and feel as though their hearts are beating double time. Often they feel they can't breathe. And at higher dosages, vomiting or abdominal cramps may develop. when the depression follows a spree or a run, the user will feel lethargic for weeks, sleep for extended periods, and even though they may be off the drug during this period, they still are prey to panic reactions, heightened anxiety and fear of losing control. Some users become so unstable that they fly into rages, become violent, and even commit suicide. At what we call near toxic levels, amphetamine brings out various kinds of bizarre behavior. You remember we were talking about cocaine in particular, about how that a user of cocaine will have hallucinations and feelings that there are bugs that are crawling either on the skin or under the skin. Well, you have to keep in mind that amphetamines and cocaine have many of the same type of reactions. They're, of course, both stimulants. Cocaine has a shorter period of effect. Cocaine, you recall, has an effect of no more than an hour, usually 30 minutes to an hour. Amphetamines, you can keep the euphoric feeling and the effects of amphetamines for 4 to 6 hours. And methamphetamine crank can even go longer than that. So you can understand why that these particular drugs would become drugs of abuse. And some of the same behaviors will be noted in an amphetamine user. He can pick and poke at things, including their skin. Now listen to this, and this is something, again, that I have personally have been exposed to, and I have seen this in operation. They become engrossed in meaningless and often repetitive tasks, like taking apart and reassembling bits of machinery, or lining up all the books in the house. I know that one of my sons said that a person under the influence of methamphetamine would be very meticulous and very detailed. And for example, it would almost be like an obsessive compulsive behavior of getting everything in line. It would almost be like scrubbing the floor with a toothbrush. And I remember one incident where this individual cut almost an acre yard when a riding lawnmower was available. But this person cut an acre yard with a weed eater. And so that pretty much bears out some of the practices of a person under the influence of amphetamine. I've also observed this, that amphetamine users can be given to amphetamine-induced psychosis, which characteristically takes on a paranoid form. It's difficult to differentiate between schizophrenia and the paranoia that's associated with amphetamine. An amphetamine-induced paranoia is difficult to differentiate from schizophrenia. The victim may withdraw or speak in seemingly meaningless sentences. Oftentimes, a person under the influence of amphetamines, their mind is racing. They can't get the words out fast enough. Mood changes are frequent. Suspiciousness grows into full-blown paranoia, and users become convinced they are targets of nameless enemies bent on doing them harm. An example would be that they're under the delusion that someone has their telephone tapped, and that the federal agents are around the corner ready to close in on them. So those are some of the negative implications of amphetamine abuse. In addition to psychosis, there are more life-threatening toxic reactions to amphetamine. Acute toxic reaction, which can be induced by doses of less than 100 milligrams, raises blood pressure, heart rate, breathing rate, and temperature. Seizures, much like epileptic attacks, can occur and may result in serious or permanent damage if medical attention is delayed. Death, although not common, can result from convulsions or a stroke. One of the frightening things, of course, about taking some of your bathtub drugs, and of course this has become much more popular since there are less laboratory-produced drugs available, is the amount of impurities that can be in the drug. And of course, these impurities sometimes can lead to the rush. The initial rush can be associated with some of the impurities in the drug, but the impurities in the drugs will also lead to a higher probability of death. Long-term effects. Stimulants can do quite a job on the body and mind. Long-term use frequently results in physical deterioration, and of course, again, physical deterioration could be related to malnutrition, improper rest, and the masking of serious problems. And this is one of the things that any type of drug can do, is to cover up or to mask some more serious disorders, that you have this sense of well-being, or you don't feel the symptoms, or you're really not aware of the symptoms of a much more serious ailment. Amphetamines put a strain on the cardiovascular system, of course, which can lead to all kinds of problems such as hypertension, irregular heart rhythm, and stroke. And then, of course, there's always the possibility of brain damage, especially for users who inject the drug. Anytime a person injects any drug intravenously, you have all of the problems that can be associated with injections, such as infected needles, blood poisoning, inflammation of the heart membrane, hepatitis, and then, of course, the possibility of AIDS. There's also the phenomenon that's referred to as burnout. The heavy use of methamphetamine can cause small blood vessels serving the brain to deteriorate and rupture, resulting in permanent damage. I had a psychologist tell me just a short time ago that one of the dangers of taking some of the street drugs or the bathtub drugs, such as crank, is that you never know when your last dosage or your last intake will be your last. What are some of the danger signs? Some of the same danger signs that are associated with any drug. But we indicated earlier in the lesson tonight that there are various explainable reasons why people will oftentimes turn to speed, amphetamines. Now keep in mind that a person can be an occasional user without, quote, being an addict. Now that's always the case. I mean, a person can be an occasional drinker of alcohol and not be an alcoholic. But you certainly always run the risk, and you don't know when one group of people might be more at risk than another because of underlying situations, underlying psychological causes, and certain vulnerabilities and susceptibilities that are possibly genetically associated. So you're always taking a high risk. And keep in mind that there are some people that, because of certain occasions, that needing that upper lift or that extra lift, or to have that, quote, extra edge, could very likely gain what they're looking for and may never become physically or psychologically dependent upon the drug. But that is an extreme, that is an unbelievable risk to take. And so one of the danger signs that would indicate that you're more than just an occasional user, that there very likely could be a problem that is close to becoming an addiction would be, are you using stimulants for purposes other than occasionally increasing your ability to perform a specific task? And then again, if you're spending an exorbitant amount of time thinking about amphetamines, then you're on the border of a problem. And that would be associated with romanticizing amphetamine use. Do you regret things you have said or done while under the influence of amphetamines? Do you need to take amphetamines or other stimulants to get you going in the morning? And that's a serious problem, isn't it? In fact, that's a danger sign for alcoholism or any other type of drug abuse, is when you need that drug to get you going in the morning. Are amphetamines affecting your sex life? As is the case with cocaine, that there are reports that sex activity is enhanced early on, but it begins to have a reverse effect, especially when you get more into the use of these drugs. So are amphetamines affecting your sex life? That would indicate that you're certainly having a problem. Do you have trouble keeping your temper? Now, of course, I know some people have problems keeping their temper and they are not drug addicts. Do you take stimulants two or more days in a row? That would indicate high risk. Are you eating normally in spite of amphetamine use? Tolerance to the different effects of amphetamine develops at different rates. Whether or not you become tolerant to the drug's ability to suppress appetite, you may still find yourself needing larger and larger doses to experience euphoria or to avoid feeling depressed and irritable. Starting off, what are some things to take into consideration in starting off? And of course, we're talking about starting off on the road to recovery, right? There are some basic things to keep in mind when you start to get off of stimulants. Again, you've got to admit you have a problem. You've got to come to the realization that you cannot control the use of stimulants. You admit you have a problem, you admit that it's out of control, you need help, you cannot do it on your own. Now see, one of the problems that we have when you're involved in amphetamine use is because we have a society that doesn't, in many instances, doesn't really seem to be too upset by the use of amphetamines. And we're talking about, of course, in what we would consider to be normal risk drug taking, because we're part of a society that thinks that, there's nothing wrong in just popping a pill to help you get by. All right, another thing that you need to be mindful of, especially in starting off on the road to recovery from amphetamine addiction, is that getting off amphetamines and staying off them can be very, very, very difficult. At the very least, you're bound to feel depressed at first, and then, of course, you have certain ill effects that can crop up even weeks and sometimes months later. If you have managed to avoid disease or infection, there's a good chance that you're malnourished or anemic and you need a high protein diet, vitamin supplements. Withdrawals from amphetamines is also of a real concern. Now, one thing that we want to point out here is that, of course, amphetamine use is highly addictive, both physically and psychologically. But withdrawal from amphetamines is usually brief and has few physical signs of symptoms. Now, this is in contrast to getting off a depressant, which is much more serious, and we'll be talking about that in the next lesson after our break. But withdrawals from amphetamines are usually, the withdrawal effects are usually quite short-lived. The impact is still very strong psychologically. Now let me point out some things that are usually associated with withdrawals. There's what we call, first of all, rebound. Rebound is a condition before a person actually goes into withdrawal. This would be if you have reached a point that you have been deprived or denied your normal, quote, fix of your drug. Some of the initial signs of withdrawal can be reflected in what is called rebound. And rebound from amphetamines or from the deprivation of amphetamines can be marked by changes in sleep patterns, including increased periods of REM sleep. Of course, you recall that REM sleep is what is referred to as rapid eye movement. And this is the type of sleep that's associated with dreaming. Users experience restless nights and vivid dreams, and sometimes quite frightening dreams. Depression is a very serious consequence of coming off of amphetamines. The depression can become so severe and the user can become so despaired that it would sometimes, in some situation, be not be uncommon for there to be an attempt of suicide. The depression will last along with disturbed sleep, lethargy, and sometimes mild tremors or shakes and muscle aches. Days later, a person in recovery can remain suspicious and hostile for a prolonged period after drug use ends. Then there's, of course, always the question as to what type of treatment that needs to be sought. And again, that depends on your personal resources. It depends on your support system. It depends on the nature, the amount of time, the length of time that you have been involved in the drugs, and how involved the drug usage has been. If you've been using daily for a month or more, or if you have experienced delusions or pseudo hallucinations and have run into real trouble in your life, such as fighting with friends and loved ones, bosses, missing work, then some type of controlled environment is probably recommended. In treatment programs, of course, you have different philosophies. We talked in general in the past about your chemically assisted programs and your totally non-chemical approaches. And your choice of a program should probably depend. Well, first of all, I think that in determining what type of program you would go into, you would probably need to do some research and to find out what basically is the philosophy. And you should be wary of any program who suggests a quick fix. If they're quick to suggest other drugs to be involved, because after all, you're trying to get off of one drug, so why get involved with a new one? There are antidepressants, of course, that are sometimes used in conjunction with the treatment program. What are some of the individual efforts that need to be made? Now, we keep in mind that only you, and when I say you, I'm talking to whoever is in treatment, that it's left up to you. It's your choice, your decision. You have to come to the conclusion that you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, and that you're going to make some necessary changes in your life. It's left up to others to help to facilitate your recovery. It's important for you to have a supportive family, but the decision is basically the one who is seeking for the help. Your support groups, your support systems are there to offer guidance, encouragement. They're there to help you to be accountable. And all of those things are very, very important. Now, what do we say that are the basic steps in recovery? Let's go back and review those very quickly, because these were some general steps for any drug. Number one is to admit you have a problem, right? To make a decision, to admit you have a problem, and to make a decision of coming off the drugs. Number two is actually getting off of the drugs. Number three is to change your lifestyle that will facilitate your staying off of drugs. And then, of course, the fourth is a continuation of stage three, or step three, and that's remaining off of drugs. Starting off, okay, well, we've already covered that. We don't want to talk about that again. Staying off, here we are, staying off. Even when you have gotten your life together and it's moving along well and you feel relatively comfortable with your abstinence, problems can still crop up. Some former amphetamine users report craving to get an up for months and even years after stopping use. And of course, this would be a psychological craving, wouldn't it? What's important is that whatever is the cue or whatever it is that would cause you to crave that drug can certainly lead you back to a renewal of your drug use, lead you back into relapse. Keep in mind that you're still going to be vulnerable to certain cues that once triggered the drug-taking response. Now, what do we mean by a cue? Sometimes it might be a sight. It might be a sound. It might be a smell. It might be any reminder that can trigger something within you that would make you to want to relapse back into drug use. It might be coming in contact with certain people that you were associated with in your drug use. It could be driving by in a certain neighborhood, any number of things. There is a treatment approach that is commonly used, and it's called, let's see, what is it called? I'm trying to think of the terminology. But essentially, it's going through a program where you have all of these cues that would normally would trigger some type of response within you to want to return back to the drugs. And under a controlled situation, you are systematically exposed to these cues, and right on the spot that you learn how to deal with that. And it's almost like a desensitization process. And for those of you that have taken some counseling courses, and we studied systematic desensitization. And again, that's when you have a hierarchy. Begin with the least anxiety-provoking cue, and you're moving down the list to a higher anxiety-provoking cue, and you move systematically from the lower level, and you keep moving up. And as these cues are exposed to you. Yeah, cue exposure. I think that's even that's the name of the technique. As you're being exposed to these various cues, then you're taught certain relaxation techniques that will help you to deal with that cue, and that will desensitize, or that will cause you to break that bond between that cue and the behavior that is undesirable. Okay, let's see where we are here. Okay. We're still talking about staying off of drugs, right? Relapse is common among amphetamine users, but it need not be tragic if there are people who can help you put it in perspective and can provide support to keep you from falling all the way back into regular use. In fact, in recovery, in just about any recovery program, you're going to be taught that in many instances that relapse is always a possibility. And in fact, relapse, at least certain degrees of relapse, are usually a part of the process. It's important, of course, that if for any reason that you would fall back into a pattern of relapse, that you would have, again, the supportive groups and the system there in place that would keep you from falling all the way back into that pattern. You will also be probably wanting to work at salvaging relationships. Now, this is something that I think is very important in the consideration of treatment. Now, we've said all along that individual counseling is usually not very effective until you have pretty much gotten on the road to recovery. In the meantime, during the treatment program, you have encounter groups, you have group therapy. You can actually be involved in, sometimes even in family therapy that can help you to deal with interpersonal relationships and so forth. But as a general rule, personal individual psychotherapy is not going to be very effective at all until you're pretty much on your road to recovery. And it's not that you have all your problems solved, but you've passed most of the intense emotional issues. And what would be some of the things that you would begin to work on? Well, number one, because of your drug abuse, that you have probably strained the most important relationships in your life. If you're married, that would be your spouse. It could be a relationship with your friends, your best friends. You could have a strained relationship with your children. So one of the first things that you would probably want to consider as a part of your ongoing treatment and staying off of the drugs would be to work at salvaging the relationships that are important to you and which have suffered probably considerably during your drug using days. If your spouse or lover has stuck with you, and of course this is the case in many instances, chances are that he or she is going to have a lot of pent-up anger and a lot of hostility that needs to be dealt with. And it's during this period of time that you need to bring anger and resentment out in the open. It's a time to begin to repair the relationships. And of course, you may need professional help to do this. Let's look at some important considerations or notes for the amphetamine user's partner. Again, we're going to repeat some of the things that we've talked about in other categories of drugs, but in every category of drugs, you're probably going to have certain notes that are going to be peculiar and unique to that particular drug. If your partner, spouse, or lover has been using amphetamines with any regularity over a prolonged period of time, you have probably been putting up with a lot. Let me stop here for a moment to also mention that you have a different scenario when both partners in a relationship are involved in the drugs. If both partners in the relationship are involved in the drugs, then recovery for one is going to be very difficult without the cooperation of the other. And I know that I have been dealing with a situation where this is the case, that you have both parties in the relationship that are involved in the drugs, and usually if they both do not come to the conclusion at the same time that they need to do something, then it's necessary that one or the other take the initiative. And even though it's going to be more difficult if one has to go it without the cooperation of the other, but if one can take the initiative and get help and then be in a position of realizing that they can no longer be an enabler, then that can certainly put the pressure on the other to get help. But let's just say that in a relationship that you have one of the parties in the spousal relationship who has not been involved in the drug use themselves. But that person who is a non-drug user has probably been exposed to a lot of abuse, misuse, and every type of emotional display and outburst imaginable, because amphetamines, drug addiction to amphetamines is probably one of the most volatile situations of any drug. Amphetamine users are just about the hardest of all drug users to live with. I'm reading that directly from a quote. Amphetamine users are just about the hardest of all drug users to live with. It is almost impossible to keep up with their mood swings. They're often depressed, irritable, and very touchy. They have trouble controlling their temper and can sometimes turn violent. At times, their behavior is simply bizarre. So your relationship is unlikely to have survived without some real damage. Oh, you may still be together. You may still be, quote, intact. But chances are that a lot of damage has already taken place. If the drug addict is ready to quit, that's good news. But being a spoiler of good news is that the bad news is he isn't going to be any easier to live with for a while. Now, that's kind of sad, but it's important that you be prepared for this. If you're talking about, and what we're doing now, we're talking specifically to the amphetamine user's partner. And you need to be aware of this. You need to be aware that there are going to be some stormy times ahead. If you go through withdrawal at home, then you've got to be aware of how extreme his depression can become. And then, of course, be ready to get medical help if that is called for. Even when withdrawal ends, his mood level may not rise all that much. Even after you've gone through the intense negative after effects of withdrawal, chances are that his mood level may not rise all that much. Then it's up to you. If you want to see this through, to do all you can to get him moving again, then it's your choice. And then, of course, some of the things to keep in mind is that you need to be there. You need to understand what basically is going on. You need to understand there's a lot of pain. There's a high level of intensity. There's a great amount of possibility of depression. And then, of course, at some point in time, it's going to be left up to the partner to suggest new activities and interests, to encourage the person in recovery to be more mindful of his or her health, to become involved in a proper diet, proper exercise program. You can play an important role by urging him to get the treatment he needs to get off the drugs or the support he needs to stay off. This will make life easier for both of you. Your own participation in the program he chooses will show you practical ways to help him and aid you in dealing with the anger and resentment you are bound to feel. And you are bound to feel them. Living with a drug user is hard. You'll probably feel shut out of his life. You can't help but resent that your love hasn't been enough to get him off drugs. But if you decide to help your spouse or lover get off drugs, letting your anger and hurt show won't help him at all. He probably already feels miserable enough. Once he has made it through, not just past withdrawal, but all the way to a new way of life and thinking about himself, then it is time to deal with your feelings. Only you can decide when his drug use becomes too much for you to deal with. And not everybody can take it. Not everybody can stand the repeated rejections that are heaped upon a drug using, or the heaped upon a non-drug using partner by the drug using one. Not everyone can deal with repeated promises and failures to quit. And not everyone can take on the burden of helping to see someone all the way through from drug dependency to abstinence. If you feel that you have to bail out of the relationship, don't take the full brunt and the load of the guilt. You've probably done all you could do to help your spouse or lover, and there's nothing wrong with starting to think and care about yourself. We have covered what I wanted to primarily cover under the stimulant or the amphetamines. And what I would like to do for just a few moments before we take a break and move on into our next session is to share with you some basic information concerning the amphetamines and the similar stimulants of abuse. And we're going to begin by giving the generic name, the brand name, the duration of effects, and the relative abuse potential. Now, we stated that we have basically three major amphetamines. Okay, we're going to call, this is going to be our broad category here, and then under that, amphetamine sulfate actually was the exact name. The brand name here was Benzedrine. The duration of effects, about 4 hours. And the relative abuse potential, high. The second amphetamine was dextroamphetamine. The brand name here being Dexedrine. Duration of effects, 4 hours. Relative abuse potential, high. Methamphetamine. Would be desoxin and methadrine. About 4 hours, high. Then we have our amphetamine like drugs. We're going to make pharmacists out of all of you, or chemists, because we're giving you all of these precise generic names. And then, of course, we're usually more familiar with the brand name, aren't we? Preludin. Now, what do we say Preludin was? That was for dieting, right? That was a diet pill. Effects, 4 to 6 hours. Potential for abuse, high. Now, we talked about Ritalin, but I'm not sure that we have yet used the generic name. And this is methylphenidate. Methylphenidate, commonly known as Ritalin. Of course, this is used for what? This is for hyperactive children. And the potential, relative abuse potential, is moderate to high. I think that Seal had told us in the last class. In fact, I was wanting Seal to share. No, there was another class. Sorry, Seal. I think it was in the adolescence class that I was wanting you to comment on. And what was it we were talking about there? We were talking about, classification of kids. A distinction made between what disruptive are your ODD and your conduct disorder. Okay. But we also have discussed, I believe, in one of the classes that Ritalin is certainly a drug of abuse, particularly in your later teens and early adulthood, more so than smaller children, because for some reason there's a different effect. Ritalin is a stimulant. It is an amphetamine-like drug, but it almost acts like a depressant in a way, because it has a way of calming out a hyperactive child. The effects are 4 to 6 hours of moderate to high abuse. Okay, and then what we call related stimulants benzphetamine. I don't know if it's showing up on the camera here or not. I'll zero in on this and let you get a closer look here in just a moment. The brand name is Didrex. Now, what do we say that some of these related stimulants were created for the purpose of supposedly having the same positive medical effects, and yet supposedly the less potent, and hopefully that would be less likely to be abused? But we talked about that if you have a less potent drug, you're just going to take more of them. And of course, this is moderate. All right, the other related stimulant is chlorpheniramine. This is Prysate, 8 to 10 hours, moderate. The next is phendimetrazine, phendimetrazine. And I'm not pronouncing these right, I don't think. Plagine, 4 to 6 hours, moderate. And the next is phendramine, phendramine. Ionamine, 8 to 10 hours, low. And then the last one is pimoline. This is Cylert, and of course Seal knows what that is, and Seal is my resource person here. Cylert is what? It is an alternative for hyperactive children. Now let's just take a look here. For example, between Cylert and Ritalin. Let's just compare the two here. Ritalin and Cylert. Ritalin, the effects 4 to 6 hours. Cylert, 10 to 12 hours. Ritalin, moderate to high abuse potential. Cialert, low. So what does that tell us right there? It tells us that Cialert is probably becoming one of your more desirable choices in dealing with hyperactive children. All right, I'm going to zero in on this and see if you can get a little bit closer look. Well, let's see. Maybe you can read that. Give you just a moment to look at it. Okay. I'll leave that on just for a couple more minutes, and we'll close out our session with this. We'll take about a 10 or 15 minute break for those of you who are viewing here locally. And we'll come back after break and we'll take a look at our second drug, our classification or category of drugs, and that will be the broad category of depressants.